There you
Hey, we got it to work through the miracle of the internet. We are making things happen.
You know, the beautiful thing about this is all brand new. Like, nobody's
Yeah.
really doing much of this right now. So I'm kind of helping pioneer this whole new way of talking to people and connecting. So this is fun, man.
Yeah,
We're
it's
just
amazing,
figuring it
man.
out.
Thanks for making it happen. I think I've done these maybe two other times, and both times I was clearly messing up something on my end. So that's usually how these go.
That's all right. Last week I had a Stephen Christian from Amberlin, and
Yeah.
he same thing. He had no idea what time zone he was in, and so
Yeah.
I'm waiting and waiting and waiting, and I'm like, I think I got stood up, guys. So ended up having to get back to it about an hour later, but we figured it
Oh,
out.
yes.
Yeah. Hey, man, thank you so much for joining in with us today.
Yeah,
Appreciate
absolutely.
you taking time out of your busy life. I see you're in your car, so you're probably running around, just going crazy, just
I
loving life.
am. I just had this weekend we're actually doing a whole youth camp
Yeah.
for our youth group, and then another youth group's jumping in with us for our church here in Sacramento.
So fun.
So I was meeting with one of the guys who helps me lead all the youth worship stuff, and which is really a great excuse to go eat sushi. So
Yeah,
yeah,
it's
I just
come
had
on.
amazing sushi and ready to talk and hang out. So
What's your go-to sushi?
honestly, I start at every menu at a sushi joint, and I look for anything with jalapenos on it. That's
Come
where I
on.
start. So.
You're speaking my language,
So
bro.
that's it. I'm like, if there's jalapenos, some kind of hot sauce, I'm in.
Come
So,
on.
yeah, but I'll eat it all. I'll love it all.
Bro, you don't know spicy until you've hung out with me, I'll tell you that much. I'm from New
Oh, I'm.
Mexico, and it's
Yeah,
spicy is life.
yeah. It is a way.
That's so
Yeah.
fun. Hey, but today I just appreciate you taking time. We're gonna have a great time. Basically, what we're doing, Derek, is we're just having a conversation about creativity, worship.
Yeah.
I
Awesome.
want you to be able to speak into the lives of our community that we've built here. Yesterday, what's today? Today's the second. 2 days ago was our 1 year anniversary of worshiping creative and just building this community of people.
Yeah.
And it's just been so fun just seeing the journey of people coming together, the messages that I'm getting. Here's what I'm getting in messages. I'm getting people saying, thank you so much for inspiring me to continue being creative and not giving up on
Yeah.
the dreams and
Yep.
hope that God has given me, you know? And so today, as we talk, I hope that the whole point and everything that we do is just inspiring these people to create, inspire them
Yeah.
to lead, and to rise up into what God's called them to do in their lives, you know?
Yeah.
And also, I got a message from Chase Wagner. He's like, that's the dude. I'm so glad you're talking to him. So
Yeah.
you
Yeah,
know
man.
her.
He's a great friend of mine, and we've had a chance to write a couple songs together as
So fun.
well. And then his song "Living with a Fire" was obviously the title track on our last Jesus Culture record. So
So crazy, bro.
yeah, so
That's so
Chase
wild.
is he's good people.
He is good people, bro. I love
Yeah.
that. I love that guy. He's from our church, and so
Oh,
I've known
okay.
him
Yeah,
since he
yeah.
was a junior in high school. So he's my
Oh, crazy.
one of my friends. But listen, what I want to do is, if you can, real quick, just
Yeah.
tell us who you are, what you do, where you're at, that kind of stuff, just in case someone doesn't know who you are.
Yeah, for sure. So, yeah, my name's Derek Johnson. I've been leading worship with the Ministry of Jesus Culture for probably the last 7, 8 years of my life. And with that has come I do a ton of itinerant ministry. I travel, go to different churches, conferences. I'm also a recording artist within our ministry, so I've done a solo record, and then I've been a part of probably 5 or 6 different compilation albums that we work on. And so that's kind of the worship leading part of it. I'm a songwriter, which is, a whole part of that recording element as well. And then, and I started leading worship at about 18 years old. I was new to the church. I was freshly saved, and I had been trying to be a rock star for, the last 6 years of my life. Have a come to Jesus moment, and kind of in that place of surrender, it was like it was worship was where I started to encounter the Lord and experience His love. And find all my longings starting to get fulfilled in that place of worship. So it's funny even to see now that, you know, worship leading or an artist, like all this has become a thing. It wasn't a thing, even this, and this wasn't that long ago for me. It was like there's maybe a few people who did it. So just going on that journey too of, I really just wanted to know the Lord. I wanted to encounter God, and all these things have kind of been the overflow of that. And but that's a ton of what I do. So I mean, I get to kind of live this stuff out. And my wife's the youth pastor in Sacramento at Jesus Culture Sacramento. That is the church that our ministry planted, I think almost 6 years ago. And so we've been here. I help her kind of build up the worship culture of what we're doing in the young people here at our church as well. And then I obviously lead worship at our home church. So, and there's like 10 other things I do, but regarding to worship, that's a thing. And I'm like I said, I referred to my wife. We've been married for almost 11 years in August. And we have two beautiful kids, Lucy and Julian. And
that's a good name, man.
That's a good name.
That's a really that's good a name. Strong name.
You've got a that's a strong name.
Somebody else shares it with
me. so that's my thing. And you know, I think I love even your heart behind doing this, because I think, especially as I get older and the longer that I've done this, the longer that I'm doing this, and all of my own like conflicted creative challenges I've experienced through the years, I think the biggest thing I want to try to encourage people in is to just keep going.
Yeah.
Like most of the times what you thought was going to be success isn't really what success is. And most of the things that you think are going to fulfill you aren't actually what are going to fulfill you.
So true.
And so having conversations like this where we can figure out a way to be honest and get at what really matters, I think is so important, particularly for creatives, because, you know, usually us creatives, we're open-minded, we're searching, we're, you know, we're like hungry for the authentic, we're hungry for the truth. And in that, we really need to encounter people who can just be honest about their own disappointments, their victories. You have to kind of be able to tell it all to really speak to people, and particularly creatives. Creatives are really good at sniffing out like, that sounded a little, you've said that 20 times, haven't you? You know? Yeah. And I love that about us. We're like on the hunt for, just be real with me, please. So, yeah.
Well, we just had someone ask, will you ever make bluegrass Christian music or worship music? Asking for a friend.
Yes, I love that. Actually, I'm in the process right now of stuff getting approved on the back end and all the things that kind of have to happen to release new music. But I have a new song that'll be coming out maybe within like the next 24 hours called We All Cry Mercy. And really the foundation musically of this song, we've added some other stuff and you know, added some cool ambience and stuff. But the heartbeat of this song is like bluegrass, gospel roots. Like that is what it is. And that is like my background in music. My parents are both born and raised in Kentucky. And so I grew up listening to gospel songs and bluegrass. And I've tried for a really long time to not write that. But it's inescapable because it's kind of in my blood.
Yeah,
so
blood. You can get rid of that, bro.
So trying to meld that a little bit with, I think there's some elements of that where, you know, even as we're talking about worship and songwriting and all those pieces, like, I think there's some elements of that old gospel music. There's a reason why it's kind of stood through the ages. Like there's something in that.
I believe gospel
could be something
the
there. Right. Just saying. I think Jesus likes the banjo.
Yes.
That's all I'm saying. So, yeah.
Well, you said that you had to come to Jesus moment. You said for the last 60 years, you've been trying to be a rock star, and then you had to come to Jesus moment. Can you just expand on that a little bit?
Yeah. So, I mean, like I was saying, I grew up with a very musical family. Like everybody played an instrument. My dad was the lead singer in a band, and they would play out in bars and clubs every weekend. And so I grew up around that. I grew up around the idea of music being an art form and music being a performance. So that's just what I knew. So, you know, fast forward to like 12, 13 years old, all I'm dreaming about, I'm like not ever thinking about school, could care less about school, but I wanted to make music and I wanted it to be a career. I wanted it to be a living. And I was like fixated on this idea of being a rock star.
Yeah.
And, because obviously that just meant like all that that represented was that's what it would mean to be successful, is that everyone thinks you're like a musical genius or something. And all the late night talk show hosts just like don't even know how to talk to you, right? This is like the thing.
Yeah.
The creatives like play over in their head. So that was kind of the driving force for years. I started a bunch of bands, and all throughout my like high school years, that's what I was going after. And I really got to, I had a few kind of significant moments where I wasn't even really following the Lord, but his sovereignty and his mercy was just, it was almost like these moments where the wisdom of God is hitting you and you don't even know it's the wisdom of God. You don't know it's the Lord. But I remember we had this moment where we were about to sign the band I was with. We were going to sign this agreement for this guy who was going to be our manager and help us do some more recordings and get us into the Chicago club scene. It was like he was our gateway into that. And for whatever reason, we like had a meeting, we reviewed the paperwork, we were going to go sign it the very next day. I came home that night with my parents. I was only like 16 years old. And I remember I said to them, I don't know why, but I can't sign that contract. And I think I have to quit this band.
Wow.
And I had something, and I know now it was the Lord, but I was so unsettled. It was almost like I knew I had a choice of two paths in front of me, and this one would work.
Yeah.
Like it actually, this would be successful.
Yeah.
And I knew like I'm going to walk away from this thing. So I quit playing music. I don't want to have anything to do with music anymore. And I was going to go to film school, just go in like a different creative arts path altogether. And it was in that season I end up meeting my now wife. And really through like the course of the first year that we dated, the Lord just pursued us in a million ways. But ultimately, we ended up in a vineyard church. And I would say this, I was so first moved by the love of the church there, that the people would remember us. And I came in very much looking the part of like, I don't belong here and I don't want to be here. Like it was all over us, you know, but at the same time, they would remember my name. They would just give us big hugs. Oh, we're so glad you're here. And I remember feeling like for the first time, maybe ever, like, wow, these people, they feel like what I think Jesus would feel like, you know? And that really kind of kept drawing us back to this church. And what would slowly happen is my kind of hard exterior shell is breaking down as these people love on us. And then they love to worship. Like this church was so passionate about worshiping Jesus, and they were super free. Like the kind of offend you, wave flags, go crazy place. And I remember going like, I don't understand this at all, but they totally have joy that I don't have.
Yeah.
Like they have a peace that I don't have. And so in that church, like my come to Jesus moment was a moment I'm standing in worship and I remember having this dialogue, right? Like there's those moments where you pray going like, I don't even know if anyone's listening, but I'm going to pray. And I said, God, if you're real, I just want you to show me that you're real. So I'm going to raise my hands in worship because I guess that's what we do. You know, I don't know why everyone's doing it. And I remember raising my hands in worship and I just felt like I felt peace. I felt peace like wash over me and I knew it was God. And I think that moment really started this fascination with like, oh, he's listening and he's real and he's relational. And like I prayed and the creator of the universe responded. I felt light where I felt heavy, you know? And man, that was kind of it. Like, you know, honestly, I would be lying if I didn't say that the dreamer in me and the ambitious kind of go-getter element of my personality didn't try to figure out, well, what would success look like as a worship leader? I certainly did. I've certainly had to walk out that journey.
Yeah.
But really in the beginning, like, I remember I didn't even want to lead worship. I didn't tell the worship pastor that I could sing.
Wow.
I was like, I'm a drummer. Can I just play drums? I need to figure out what this is. I know it's not what I've done for years on a stage.
Yeah.
So what is it? Just trying to come in as a learner and figure out, how do we, like, what is this worship thing?
Yeah.
And so, man, that kind of kickstarted my journey in leading worship. It was my wife, actually. Again, we were dating at the time, but she's the one who went to the worship pastor and was like, he will never tell you that he can sing, but he writes songs and sings, and he was in a band for years. And I was super mad at her for doing that. I was like, that's not why I want to be here, you know?
Yeah.
But that kickstarted that season for sure. Yeah.
Yeah. That's crazy. What a good wife, though, to challenge you in that way.
Yeah, she's, you know what? She's done that exact thing like 30 times over. So
I feel that. My wife, she could probably hear me right now. She challenges me every day.
Right, yes.
To be better, you know?
Yeah. We used to laugh. There's a lyric from a song we listened to all the time when we were dating, but the lyric was talking about a girl with a box full of suggestions for your possible heart. And I was like, that is the metaphor for my entire relationship. Just my wife with a suggestion box. Like, hey, you should probably do this, but do what you want, but you should probably do this. And then she's usually right. So.
That's so funny. My wife always just said, I would always just duck and allow God to hit you in the face rather than me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. He'll convince you pretty quickly. So
that's so good, bro. I love hearing that because I think there's a lot of people in our field when it comes to creativity, whether it's worship or graphic design, or, you know, videography. I mean, there's so many creatives who, what they want really is to be recognized. What they really want is to create so that they're the best, or they have a following, or they have fame.
Yeah.
And I see a lot of that in people. And I mean, I wouldn't lie. I've been leading worship since I was 12 years old, and probably up until the 3 years ago, I really thought, you know, like, this is, I have to make this a thing. I have to make this a, you know, whatever. And my mind was just so about me. And then God literally strips everything away from my life at the same time and helped me realize that it has nothing to do with me, you know? And so, I think that's so good to hear you say, just like, hey man, like, it's not about being a rock star. It's not about being the number one guy on the stage, really. Like, it's just your relationship with Jesus and authentically coming to him with the heart of worship, you know? And
I think too, and the more that you talk to other creatives, if you really get down to it, at some point they've all struggled with this. Yeah. We all have a need for significance. We all have a need. The challenge is not even the challenge. The reality is that we already are significant. That actually should be part of the revelation of Jesus's love for us. And it's the thing that I'm beginning to figure out. It's like, oh, what we don't realize is there are so many things that we pick up along the way thinking this is going to give me significance. Oh, if I just get to this stage or to that place or whatever, then I'll be significant. And the problem with that is I don't think you can hold both of those things at the same time.
Yeah.
You really have to let that go. And in being able to let that go, you find out, like, oh man, God already loved me fully. He already fully was pleased in me just because I'm me, because my heart's to serve him. And I think that is maybe one of the most impactful revelations that we could have as believers is, like, are we still tying all of our significance to the things that we do?
Wow.
Are we still trying to earn a love that we are supposed to receive as a gift? You know,
Now
that becomes a challenge in ministry too, because there's a lot of good things to do. There's a lot of problems to be fixed.
There is, yeah.
There are a lot of good works to be done. We're called to that for sure. Absolutely. I just think the problem is we miss out that what Jesus is trying to do is love us fully. And because we're fully loved, that overflows onto other people. And this is a journey for all of us. I mean, I feel like I'm 32. I feel like I'm just beginning to scratch the surface of what really matters. So
absolutely. We are. I'm 33, bro. And I feel like my ministry has just begun, and I've been in it for the last 12 years, you know, of my life. Yeah. And I think really it's finally just, for me, it's coming to a point where I'm able to just empower people and help people understand, yeah, realize that you are significant. You know, one of the, yeah, one of the things I respond to a lot of people after, you know, if I share their post or something that they created and I highlight them as an artist, the hashtag I try to use all the time for them is keep creating, because it's so, yeah, easy to give up. So easy to give up because we're disappointed in the results that we saw, yeah, right away, rather than just creating for, just create for the Lord, you know, let, right, that be your worship. And if he does something with it, that's amazing. If he doesn't, and it's just worship between you and the Lord, that's really all that matters, you know?
Yeah. I mean, you know, the Lord always reminds me and brings me back to when I describe the moment of like, I'm in worship. I feel the presence of God. I feel peace. Yeah. And it kind of changes everything for me. The months following that, I would so many nights out of the week, I'd get an acoustic guitar. I'd go in my bedroom. I was 17 years old. I would lock the door, hoping that no one hears me or walks in or sees, yeah, anything that's about to go down, because I'm going to go back and find that spot with Jesus again.
Wow.
I want to worship, and you're going to show up. And that is so the most amazing thing to me. And no, yeah, one was watching. No one was telling me good job. That I'd never even would have connected, yeah, those dots. It felt so private and so intimate that it's like, I don't even want anyone to walk in here.
Yeah.
Then you flip the script to, okay, now we're doing it in ministry, and now we're in church, and now, yeah, we're on a stage. Can you protect that spot?
Yeah.
In that spot. And so that is the challenge.
So true. If you can hear me, you're paused at the moment for some reason. I may have lost you. If you're online right now and hear us, and he's gone. Well, that was so good. I hope you're encouraged by that. Maybe we might join back in with each other in just a moment. We'll see. His phone may have gotten overwhelmed like Brandon Lakes did. We'll just wait here for a second. Rapture. If that's the case, then I messed up. Let's see if there's anybody. Let's see if he comes back. Could have just been his phone. Sometimes Instagram Live, I'm realizing, overwhelms people's phones. Mine's fine, but some people lose it. Yeah, he's so good. Derek Johnson is so, so, so good. That's why I really wanted to be able to have this conversation, speaking life over us. Let's see if he joins back in here in just a moment. We're going to give it a chance. Hey, Jay, how you doing? Hope you're having a great day at work. I'm having a great day at home, recovering after building a fence yesterday in my yard. Oof. Let's see if he comes back. We'll just wait here. So true. So true. That's good. His phone was overwhelmed by the word. The Lord speaking through him. Looks like we got him back.
Hey. Hey, I heard that. It was overwhelmed. Literally, my phone, I've never had it happen before. It said the phone was too hot, and,
yep,
then it just shut down on me.
Yep.
So it was heating up. That's what was going on.
Yeah, the Lord was people were just like, oh, man, the rapture happened. Oh, no, the word of the Lord coming through his mouth was too powerful and overwhelmed his phone.
That's like, what it was.
We'll just wait and see if he comes back. No, that happened with Brandon Lake.
It couldn't handle it.
I was talking to Brandon Lake a couple weeks ago, and the same exact thing. His phone tripped out and overheated. So I figured.
I'm still amazed that this works at all. So
isn't it amazing?
I was just telling someone yesterday, like, I am old enough to remember no internet life.
Yeah, absolutely.
So this is astounding. For all you young people out there, you don't realize there was a time where this was still only in movies. So that's true. It. And that makes me sound really old, I know, but I'm just embracing it. So
hey, rapture canceled. That's what that comment.
Yeah, that's.
No, I remember dial up AOL.
Oh yeah.
You know, junior high.
And I don't even know, like, you couldn't even do anything. The internet was so slow. Nothing really worked.
We actually had to do schoolwork and, like, read and not just look it up on the internet to see what the answer was.
And you were, like, paying by the minute to be online. Yeah. So
absolutely.
It was incredible. We've come a long way.
We have, bro. Well, thanks for coming, getting back on with us, man.
Yeah, yeah.
But we were just talking through that stuff. So tell me, let's just go to another line of things. When
you're
writing songs and you're having, you know, you're just having a moment, what does that look like for you to create something new out of nothing?
Yeah. Well, I mean, for me, that specific process, honestly, that almost feels like one of the most natural things that I do. Because, like, honestly, even more than that process of like sitting down with a guitar and in a notepad and starting to just express what's going on in my heart.
Yeah.
That's been my go-to since I started doing it. Like the moment I started writing songs, I remember figuring out like, oh, I feel like I can articulate all my thoughts and all my feelings here better than anywhere else.
Yeah.
But I think there has always been a challenge for me kind of bridging that gap, particularly in worship, because there are a lot of, I'm not just singing songs for me, you know, and I'm not just singing songs about any old theology I'd like to throw out there.
Yeah.
There's some importance of making sure, particularly in worship music, that what I'm saying is theologically sound and authentic. But I think where I've really landed in that process is for worship writing specifically, as long as I'm staying fed, truly, like I'm in the word, I'm connecting to that. I have to realize that part of what's going to come out of me is going to be that. Like that's some of what's going to come out in the songwriting. And it's allowed me to, I actually remember having a conversation one time with Jeremy Riddle. I was showing him a song and I could tell, you know, he kind of sensed my holding back in the writing. He heard me sing some other songs that weren't necessarily worship. And I remember him saying like, you know, I heard those songs and like, you're a real writer. I've heard you really write. And this is a good song that you're showing me, but it doesn't totally feel like that thing. And he could really pick up on that. I had all these reservations when it was coming to worship music. Like, I don't know how to really let myself be in the song and be really honest and be really vulnerable. And so that's been part of the journey.
Yeah.
It's like, can you, I always go back to David when we're talking about writing worship songs. The fact that he could sit there and complain for like 20 verses about, you know, so the burden of his soul, and he's surrounded on all sides by enemy and all of, like, he could express everything that's going wrong. And then he actually leads us back to, oh, but God, you'll be my safety. You'll be my salvation. You'll be faithful to me. That thing to me feels like the most interesting thing that we could continue to press into as worshipers.
Yeah.
Because I do think our lives sometimes, you know, even if you've got a million areas going right, there's going to be those areas where, God, I still have this thing and it's not doing me any good not to look at it and not to name it and say, here's that thing that's not doing so well, but I know you'll be faithful, you know?
Yeah. So true.
So David's ability to capture that is incredible. But anyway, to answer your question, that process for me, I think for all of us as songwriters, it really is about uncapping that well and producing content. And the thing I left out, I remember Jeremy telling me, hey, you can always go back and edit anything.
Yeah.
So get it all out. Let it all out on the page.
Absolutely.
Express what you're feeling. Because I think for most of us, too, is you'd find in that mode as a songwriter, you're actually saying something now.
Yeah.
Like you're not just throwing up a bunch of cliches. You're not just like recycling the 20 songs you lead on a Sunday in your own order. You're really saying something.
Yeah.
And if you're really saying something, I'm pretty convinced that will resonate with God's people.
So true.
Yeah.
Wow. I like that. What spoke to me just now is that you're actually saying something, because I think it's so easy to repeat what everybody else is saying. Which is okay. I mean, here's the thing.
Sure.
Nothing's new under the sun. You think you came up with something original? You did not. It's right. Already been said. There's 7.4 billion people out there. Someone said it.
Yeah.
But I think the most important part, like you said, is having a moment where you're just expressing exactly what your heart is crying out at the moment. Like you said with David.
Yeah.
Man, we were just talking about this the other day with a couple of friends, but how David just complains and complains and complains, but he always ends with, but the Lord is faithful. The Lord is good.
Yes.
He always comes through. He is our strong tower. He's a mighty, you know, all this stuff. So at first you're reading it and you're getting a little depressed, you know what I'm saying? But then he always turns it around and says, but you need to realize that God is good, you know?
Yeah.
And
I think that's a challenge too for us as creatives. It's like, it's not, I don't want to lead people from my talents and from my gifts, although I do have them. And so do you guys. Like, God's given you gifts and talents, things that you just do naturally. But I'm probably not, I could do better than that. I could lead out of conviction. I could lead out of that spot of, I really believe what I'm saying.
Yeah.
And so that can be, I mean, that's the beautiful thing about it's being worship leaders. I'm not only singing my song. I sing other people's songs that I'm like, oh man, every time I sing that new Hillsong song, I'm just crying. And like, cause I believe it, man, that would be my gift. That'd be the thing that I could, that's my conviction. That's what I could lead from.
So
I think it's super important when we're writing songs, like, and they're not all going to feel this way. Probably most of them won't probably always feel that way. When you hit the ones where you're like, man, this really feels like I'm saying something. This feels like the season that me and my family has been in. This feels like the season that, my church, my community, my friends, this feels like our season.
Yeah.
Well, now that's actually something that might move the ball down the field.
Yeah.
So to speak, true. To use a sports analogy, and I'm not a sports guy. So there you go.
I'm always so proud of guys like you who don't do sports. And
I'll just take a shot at it. I could use MMA analogies. I know that fairly well, but I don't know. Throw a ball in the mix. And I'm like, yeah, whatever. So.
That's so funny. I didn't pick up playing guitar or anything until I was 15. It was all sports up until that point. So a little different for me. I get it.
Yeah.
But man, hey, thank you so much just for taking some time for us.
Sure.
Even just the short time we had together, like, you had so many good things for us to even just hear. And people were just writing and commenting just how encouraging what you were saying was. But if we could do this, if we could just pray over our community. And because this is going to go, you know, we'll put this on IGTV and YouTube, and
awesome.
it'll get a lot of views and stuff. But I just want them to be imparted by you of whatever comes to your heart.
Yeah. Awesome. Cool.
Awesome. Thanks, bro.
Yeah. Yeah. Jesus. God, I thank you for the creatives, God. I feel like they really are such a reflection of such an important part of who you are.
Yeah.
That you are the creator, and there are, I think we're all creative, but there are certainly some of us who, so we have this inclination, this special ability to tap into your heart, God, and really to see the world in a way that it could be, to see things in the way that they could be, and that we'd want to be those who go on that adventure and we go on that journey, God, to shape culture, to shape our churches and what you're doing in worship and what pursuing Jesus looks like in our generation. And I thank you, God, for these creatives, God, just for that desire on their hearts to think outside the box and to go to places that other people won't go. And so, Lord, I pray that for every person who listens to this, that you would fill them with courage, God, to innovate, to think differently, God, to really be themselves. And I pray that would flow out of this place of knowing how fully they are loved by you, Lord.
Yeah.
That for every person listening to this, that they would even once again, just embrace that journey to say, God, what are the things that I am holding on to, that I am clinging to, that actually stand in the way of me believing that you fully love me right now?
Wow. Yeah.
Just as I am, right where I'm at, and that you want to meet me in that spot. I believe with all my heart that the greatest creativity flows out of that spot.
Yeah.
When you can embrace that Jesus knows you exactly where you're at right now, exactly in the season you're at, all the mistakes, all the missteps, all the disappointments, and even all the passion and all the dreams, every bit of it, Jesus is right there in the midst of it, wanting to invite each one of us on a journey. And so, God, I pray you give them courage. You give them new levels of creativity. And I pray, Lord, in every place that they're represented, every team, every church, every community, Lord, I pray that you give them courage to show up and really be themselves, to really be vulnerable with the things that you've put on their heart. Because I do believe that is a key to shifting the cultures that they're in, to bringing that part of your heart, God, that I really believe only they can bring, that you've uniquely deposited those dreams, those passions in their hearts for a purpose, so that they would show up and bring it to the table. So
thank you,
Jesus, we bless every person listening. We bless them in your name, God. And I pray that you would once again just pour out your love, God, that they would be receivers of your love.
Yes, Jesus.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Wow, appreciate that, bro. It's a little bright now.
Yeah, hey, there it is. Looking good.
Hey, quick question. What kind of coffee do you drink?
All of it, but I...
What's your go-to?
My favorite, I'm into all sorts of roasters, but I always start with Ethiopian origin beans.
Okay, yeah.
Where I can get that, like, fruity pop going on is my favorite. But I actually love, we have a roaster, Temple Coffee, out here in Sacramento.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's amazing. I love Kova. All those. They're great.
So incredible, man. Well, next time you're out here, you need to stop by Olympia Coffee.
I'm in.
It'll change your life.
Consider it done.
Awesome. And then another question. Do you watch like superhero movies?
I have. I mean, I've watched some of them.
Are you into them or you're not into them?
I'm into, like, I'm a major X-Men fan.
Okay.
And I love, like, Spider-Man. I love all things Batman.
I don't know too many X-Men fans.
I'm in, bro. Wolverine was my guy when I was a kid.
Okay.
So, but yeah, like all things Batman, I'm way into.
You're dark. Okay, I see. Where
I'm into the like I said, I want it to be real, authentic. I don't need the superhero fluff. I need a hero with some problems. That makes sense to me.
That is so great. Are you going to go see Spider-Man?
Yeah, for sure.
Awesome. I'm taking a group of four guys tonight.
Oh.
Yeah, 10 o'clock. Ooh,
see,
my
kind of next on our list are like the kid movies. I gotta go see. What's the one that just came? I know. There is one that's out. Aladdin. A remake of Aladdin. I gotta go see that. Take my daughter. So I showed her the original animated version so that it's like you need to know the right way, and then I'll show you the remake. So we got that base covered.
Toy Story 4 was incredible.
That's another one. So that's what I'll be seeing when I go to the theaters. I have no choice. That's it.
You have to. It's so great.
If I'm going to see Spider-Man, I'm going to have to go later when kids are in bed.
That's what I do. 10 o'clock tonight. I'm getting way too old for this.
See ya.
All right, bro. It was good.
Hey, man.
Good talking.
Thanks so much.
With you.
Yeah, you too.
Thank you so much.
All right. Yep, take care.
See ya. Bye. Hey, man. How's it going? Can I hear you? Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. I can.